Good afternoon, and this is Sharon Kluck with Mind and Messiah Ministries. We are doing our midweek teaching. We started a series last week on Teshuva, which means repentance, or to turn and to repent. So last week, we went over the story of David and Bathsheba, and what a debacle that was. One sin of lust led to another and another and another, and ultimately it led to generational curses. And it didn't just affect David. So our sin doesn't just affect us. Often it will affect generations after us. So that one bad decision, even though we repent for it, there are consequences. So that seems to be the problem. This morning when I listened to Derek Prince, one of the things that he talked about was a young man who had a hard time receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he said, yeah, I'm baptized in the Holy Spirit, but I don't speak in tongues. And the first thing Derek Prince said to him, have you ever been to a fortune teller? And he said, well, yeah, but I was only 15 years old. And I just did it for fun. It didn't mean anything. Well, it's the same thing we talked about last week. It's not what it means to you. It's what it means to God. And when we go to fortune tellers or mediums, we're seeking the knowledge and supernatural wisdom from somebody besides God. The Word of God is already providing that for you. So when we choose another source of power and knowledge instead of God's, that's actually a form of adultery. As His bride, we're saying we trust this more than we trust God. Well, the problem is that people don't know the Word of God. They don't get in it, they don't read it, and they don't know it. And so they don't even know that you're not supposed to consult mediums. You're not supposed to consult fortune tellers or get involved in witchcraft. Nobody's telling them that. We have a crazy liberal society that just thinks anything goes because they're forgiven and by grace are they saved and nothing else matters. Well, it matters to God because He still get angry. He still has feelings. He still gets hurt. He still feels rejected. He made us in His image. And He made us to have emotions and to feel things. Well, He has emotions and He feels things. We see all the time in the scriptures where God is either rejoicing over us with gladness or He's angry. And so we have to decide which route we want to take. So when we talk about keeping God's commandments, we don't talk about keeping God's commandments so that we can be saved. We're already saved. We're saved by the blood of Jesus. Paul says we are already sealed, that we are marked and we are sealed for the day of redemption. So we belong to our Messiah. We are His, but it's our choice if we want to live a life that's pleasing to Him or if we just want to do our own thing and be pleasing to ourselves. So who is your God? Are you your own God? Or is He really God of all? And how much God is He in your life? How much power, how much authority does He have in your daily walk and what you do day by day in the decisions that you make? And often we're making decisions without ever consulting God. Sounds like a good deal. Someone comes and they show us a great way to make money and boy, we're gonna try that. God will surely bless it, won't He? We'll do the work and God will bless it. What if it's not His will for you to do that and you get started doing it? If we would consult God about everything that we do, we would have far less heartache in our life. So would we have less effect on our children and our children's children, on our spouses and on our finances and on our destiny and on our purpose in this life. Because God is our creator. He's our papa. He's the only God in the world that claims to be our father. Every other God is vicious, demanding, wanting you to sacrifice something all the time. But this is a loving and a kind God who wants a relationship with you. So today we're going to take a look at when Moses went up to Mount Sinai after the sin of the golden calf, Moses goes back up on Mount Sinai for the third time to plead with God, because God is ready to destroy the entire nation of Israel. Moses has been on the mountain for a very short time, and they build a golden calf and they worship the golden calf as God. It doesn't even, to us, it doesn't make sense. When you start breaking it down a little bit with a little more detail, it makes a little more sense, but we don't have time for that in this teaching. We could talk about that at a later date. But they built the golden calf, and God is ready to destroy all of them. He tells Moses, you better get down there. I'm going to annihilate the whole bunch of them. So Moses goes back up on the mountain, and he takes stones back with him so God can rewrite the Ten Commandments, because Moses has broken those Ten Commandments when he threw them down. When he saw that they had sinned with the golden calf, it's like, these commandments mean nothing. This is a marriage ketubah. This is God's loving instructions for us, but we don't want to do them. We're already in adultery. We've already sinned against God. We've already chosen another God. So this is what happens on the mountain, is God and Moses, they meet face to face. And I asked God about that as I meditated on this, like, God, what was that like? What was that like? And for just a second, I heard this huge noise. It was just a second. I tried to actually write down what it sounded like, and I couldn't do it. But it was just a second. I heard this huge noise, like the presence of God. Woo, you know. And it was, his presence was massive, and it was flaming, and it was fierce, and he speaks to Moses face to face. Now, the Bible tells us all this stuff, that the mountain is burning. It tells us the voice of God thunders and the whole earth shakes, but we weren't there. And it's really hard for us to imagine how frightening that might have been. The people actually said to Moses, you go hear what he's got to say and we'll do it. Well, what they were saying is that on this ketubah that he's asking us to be obedient to, we're saying, I do. We're saying, we agree, we will do it. And they don't even know for sure what God's gonna say. It was that frightening for them. We'll do it, we'll do whatever he says. So I just thought for a moment that this must have been so utterly out of this world, that's all I can say, for Moses to see God and to be able to communicate with him. And I'm sure he met with Moses. We say he met him face to face. God says he speaks to him face to face, but he is always covered. He's either covered in a cloud or he's covered in a flame. He says, on the mountain, you saw no similitude. You didn't see any form of anything. So don't go making something that you think is God. Don't make some kind of image that you think looks like me that you can bow down to, or that you can worship. That's why he tells us not to make graven or carved images. So we're gonna start today, and we're gonna take a look at what happened on the mountain and what God says about who he is. And then we're gonna take a look at ourselves and see how we line up with who God really is. So in our study of Teshuva, we've got a few key verses. And so we're going to read those first. Psalms 51, and we're going to read 6 through 10. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inner parts. Remember, we talked about inner parts. We have inner parts that we are not even aware of that we have. The heart is deceitful above everything. God tells us that in Jeremiah. Jeremiah 17 is where that is. So in Psalms 51, 6, I think most of you are there now. Behold, thou desirest truth. That's what God wants. He wants truth in our inner parts. He doesn't want us living lies. Many of us have believed lies about ourselves, about other people, and about God. The enemy has fed us lies all of our life. We think other people are judging us, when maybe they haven't even had a thought about that. We think other people dislike us when they actually have no opinion about us. We think that we'll never accomplish anything, or that we're too stupid to learn to read and write and be intellectual, or to do anything that's worth any value. And we believe those lies. Those lies are from Satan himself. And what happens, we live our whole life according to those lies rather than the truth. So what God wants in your inner parts is the truth. And he says, my word is truth. So for us to get our grasp the truth of who we are, we have to grasp the truth about who God is. So I desire truth in the inner parts, and in the hidden parts, thou shalt make me to know wisdom. So we have inner parts and we have hidden parts. Who do you think those parts are hidden from? From us, from ourselves. They're not hidden from God. We think they're hidden from God. We think we hide them from other people. We're foolish to believe such things. God knows every thought and every intent of your heart. Verse 10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with your free spirit. So here is David. This is after the sin of Bathsheba and killing Uriah, and he is praying to God, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. So this is what I want to ask you. David is now an adulterer, and he's also a murderer. Is that an unclean spirit that is residing in him at that moment? I would think so. Something that would prompt him to murder and commit adultery is an unclean and lying spirit. And yet he says to God, take not your Holy Spirit from me. So the Holy Spirit is residing in a man who also has a spirit of murder and a spirit of adultery within him. So when people tell you that Christians cannot experience the two worlds or the two kingdoms within themselves at the same time, the word is contrary to that. We open doors, and our soul, not our spirit, our soul gets contaminated. Our soul is our mind, will, and emotions, and it gets contaminated with the lies of the devil. David looked at Bathsheba, he thought he could get by with this. He thought he could get by with it. He thought he could bring Uriah home, and Uriah would go into his wife, and he'd think that when she was pregnant that it was his child instead of David's. What do you think would have happened then? If she would have done that, don't you think David would have been looking out after this child all of his life and be going, you know, that's really my son over there, you know? Even though he would have got by with the secret sin, he would have still always been regretting that he didn't have a relationship with his own son. Sin has consequences. So what David was fearful of was that he had sinned and had such an evilness within him that needed to be confessed and cleansed, that he would lose the power of the Holy Spirit. But God didn't take his Holy Spirit from him. When we talk about the gifts of God that are without repentance, he's talking to Israel. The gifts and callings of Israel are without repentance. But we can also take that to apply to us. When God fills you with the Holy Spirit, he doesn't take it away from you. Once you have it, it's there forever. You're the one that can quench it. You're the one that can say, I'm not moving in this anymore. I'm going to ignore it. I'm going to ignore the Spirit of God within me. And it's all about who you feed. Who you feed. What spirit are you going to feed in your life? Are you going to feed the lies of the devil? Are you going to feed the Spirit of God within you? So David was concerned about losing the authority and the power of the Holy Spirit. So this week, we're going to start with a little bit of review. Last week, we learned that the 40 days of Teshuva, repentance, coincides with other biblical events. It coincides with the testing of our Messiah. So when Jesus went into the wilderness for 40 days and he was tested of the devil, it coincides with this 40 days of Teshuva, of repentance that we're going through right now. And it led up to the Day of Atonement and to the Feast of Tabernacles. The same 40 days are when Moses was on the mountain pleading with God. And that's why we're looking at those scriptures today. He's up there saying, God said, I'm going to annihilate all of them, Moses, and I'm going to make of you a nation. And Moses goes, no, God, these are your people. They're not my people. They're your people. You're the one that redeemed them. And if you do this thing, the world will say that you were not able to deliver them into the promised land. And Moses is defending God to himself and saying, this is what the world will say about you. This is what the world will think about you. You can reason with God if you are in that kind of relationship with God, like Moses was. I'm not sure that any of us really are, but we're striving to be. So we saw in last week's lesson that one terrible lustful decision can lead to another, and that our sin doesn't only affect us, but many others, and it hurts people that we love. We saw the generational repercussions of David's sin and how it ended up poisoning his entire family. So truly, our sin against God, in the long run, as children of God, we don't seem to have any compassion for our Father. So the sins that we commit are not just against ourselves, they're not just against others, but we sin against God. That's what David said when he was repenting. He said, against you and you alone have I sinned. Well, he sinned against other people too, but he realized that he sinned against Yahweh. So we sin against God, and we somehow think that God doesn't have feelings, but that is not true. We can hurt him with our actions, with our words. We can see better every day how he was tested in all ways like we are. He knows rejection without a doubt. He knows betrayal. He knows hatred. Now, as I say these things, think about how you know those things. You know those things. You know rejection. You know betrayal. You know hurt. He knows hatred. He knows disloyalty. He knows indifference. And he knows all the things that we experience. He said he was tested in all ways like we are. Because he still endures this kind of treatment from his children every single day. His children reject him every single day. So yesterday when I spent some time with the Lord, and I try to just sit before him and not make an agenda about what I want him to say to me or hear from him. I just try to sit before him and just listen, see what he's saying. And so as I was thinking about this message and the feelings of God, and that he actually has feelings, that he gets angry, that he gets happy, that he feels the things that we feel. And he said to me, Sharon, do you know why so many people who love me have wayward children? And I didn't answer him because he kept talking. And he said, I permit that in their life. I permit it because I want them to know how I feel, because so many of my children constantly reject me. Everything I've taught them, everything that I have given them, they they don't even appreciate anything that I do for them. And they hurt me. And if you're never rejected by your own children, if you never are hurt because they don't appreciate all the good, wonderful biblical teaching that you gave them as a child, you will understand then how I feel. Because my children do this to me every single day. So we have people around the table today who have children who've gone astray. And this is what he said to me. If you would care as much about my children and pray as much about my lost children as you do for your own, yours would return. Wow. Wow. We don't do that. We don't pray for God's lost children the way that we pray for our own. We cry out to God. We plead. We shed tears. We have gut-wrenching moments crying out to God for our children. We don't want them to go to hell. We don't want them to lose the blessings of living a wonderful life for Christ. Well, God doesn't want that either. And he has children everywhere that once were alive and active and pursuing him that have been drawn away by the world. They've been drawn away by the lies of the devil. And so his desire for us is that we would begin to feel what he feels. When Moses was on the mountain with God in the book of Exodus, after the sin of the golden calf, he met God face to face as he pleaded for the children of Israel not to be destroyed. And then Yahweh descends out of the cloud to meet with Moses. And this is what he declares. So now we're in Exodus 34, 5. If you'd like to go over there, this is a very well-known scripture. And these are the attributes of God. And many people know these particular scriptures as the attributes of God that God himself has declared. So we're at Exodus 34, verse 5. And the Lord descended in the cloud, and he stood with him there, and he proclaims this, the name of Jehovah. That word, Jehovah, in the Hebrew is H3068. It means the self-existing or eternal one. Nobody made God. He is self-existent. He is eternal. He has no end. He has no beginning. And because he is not locked into time, hear this. God is not locked into time. Time is for this earth. God is not locked into time. We are the prisoners of time. And since Satan lives in our realm, he too is subject to time. God is not. Satan only has so long to get his job done. God has forever. Satan knows that his time is short according to the word of God. However, God is not subject to our time frame. And that's why we often feel like he's not on time. But that's our perception. That's not his. There is no time constraint on God the Father, Yeshua. He is the creator of time. It is his design. He created it. He can alter it any way he wants. He can make the earth stand still if he wants to. He can speed it up. He can slow it down. He can do whatever he wants. And sometimes the devil and man don't even realize they don't have the power to do that. They're busy trying to control the weather. They're trying to control the movement of the earth. They didn't create it. And they certainly didn't create time. That's a creation of God. So he continues to proclaim his attributes to Moses as they enter into a dialect regarding the future of the people of Israel. So in verse 6, he says, And the Lord passed by before him, and he proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth. So Moses is up there to plead for these people, and God says, well, Moses, this is who I am. This is who I am. I am abundant in goodness and truth. I am merciful. I am gracious and I'm long-suffering. It's almost like he's saying, okay, let's talk. These are my attributes. Let's talk. Verse 7, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and the fourth generation. And Moses made haste, and he bowed his head towards the earth, and he worshiped. I'm telling you, if I even got a one moment glimpse of this with that loud clash when he began to speak to Moses, and the incredible massive presence that is saying, this is who I am. I am Yahweh. I am. I am. And this is who I am. I'm merciful. I'm a long-suffering. I'm full of truth. I'm full of mercy. I'm full of goodness. That's who he is. For people who just think he's a mean old judgmental God, that's because they don't know who he really is. This is who God, Jehovah, Yahweh, is. So do you know him as merciful? Compassionate? The definition of compassion is a deep awareness of the suffering of others. Do you think he has a deep awareness of your suffering? Do you think he has a deep awareness of the suffering of others? Accompanied by the wish to relieve it. He wants to relieve it. He wants to. Sometimes we hold up what he wants to do by our big mouth because we keep saying what the devil says instead of saying what the word of God says. He has pity. And he suffers along with others and he has sympathy. What about you? When you hear of the 1,000 people missing in a flood, do you even think twice about it? As we prayed Monday night, this disaster came up and I had a vision of a mid-sized tan dog. It was tan color. And it wasn't a big dog. It was just a mid-sized dog. And he was scratching and he was pawing through the mud after the flood, trying to flee a person that was crying for help and not being able to be able to get free. So they were praying for help, and God sent an animal. God sent an animal to answer their prayer. So without seeing in the spirit what others are going through, we don't have the compassion for them. I heard about this. I heard about the big flood, but it wasn't until I was in prayer and praying in the spirit that the Lord showed me what I was praying about. And all of a sudden I saw this and I realized the devastation. There was nothing left. There was mud everywhere and people were buried under mud where the water had just rushed them away and the mud came up on top of them. I mean, we don't think about that. We hear this on the news and we just keep going our merry way. Do you think God did? He had compassion. He knows exactly what's going on, even if he has to send an animal to rescue us. So we, if we will pray in the spirit, often God will show us what we're praying about. We may not understand the words we're saying, but in our heart and our mind, we begin to see. That's why I say to you that my ability to pray in tongues and being filled with the Holy Spirit is my keeping power. It opens up my spirit to see. I don't know what to pray for. I didn't know to pray for that person until God showed it to me. But as you pray in the Spirit, God opens up your spirit to see, and you know how to pray. You have compassion. All of a sudden, you feel what God feels, because God is saying, this person needs help. Can you help? Can you help to pray in this? Can you over here across the world be praying about that and help for these things to happen for these people? We have no idea what our prayers do. We have no idea who we help. We will not know until we get into eternity when we see if it is true what I saw about the house of God with the clear stones that told your whole life and it just kept going. If that is true, it'll show up when you prayed for somebody that you didn't even know, but you let the Holy Spirit pray through you and make intercession for the saints and help got sent. What about you? What if you were washed away in the mud? You would want somebody else praying in the Spirit for you. And we didn't even know we were praying about that. We just gathered together. We were praying about what we thought we should. We had a list of things to pray about, but God wanted to pray about something else. And that's what came up. And that happened several times in our prayer time Monday night. We went on subjects that we had no idea we were going to pray about because that's what the Holy Spirit led. That's why David said, take not the Holy Spirit from me. He leads you. He guides you. He speaks into your very being and helps you to see things that you would never, ever see. So he's gracious. He's compassionate. He's merciful. So without seeing in the Spirit, we don't know how to have compassion. We don't know what they're going through. But God doesn't miss a beat. He doesn't miss a thing. He sees it all. He is gracious. The word gracious is H2603. It means bent or stooped in kindness to an inferior, to favor, to bestow, to move to favor by petition, to give, grant, or to make supplication. So when God stoops in kindness, he's not bowing down to us. We are inferior to him. It's like he comes down. We're crying out. He comes down, sends his spirit down to us who are inferior to him, and he ministers to our need, and he offers a hand, a kindness to us. And this is what he does for us. He stoops in kindness to us. We are inferior to him, and he bows down from the heavens to hear us, to render kindness to us, to bestow favor upon us, and to favor us because we are his children. He grants us our petitions, and he makes supplication for us. And we know that because of Hebrews 7. Hebrews 7, 22 says, by so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament, and it's better because we don't have the old priesthood. He is the high priest. He never dies. And they truly were many priests then, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. All those priests just kept dying and they had to have another one. Our priest never dies. He is eternal. Verse 24, but this man, because he continueth forever, hath an unchangeable priesthood, wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come to God by him. So we come to God through Yeshua. He's able to save us to the uttermost, completely saved. Nothing about us that's not been regenerated. Nothing about us that hasn't been saved. He's able to save us to the uttermost, seeing that he liveth to make intercession for us. And he does it every single day. For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled. He's holy, he is harmless, he is undefiled. Separate from sinners, he's separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself. Hallelujah. So Jehovah is long-suffering. He's patient. And thank God he's slow to anger. Folks, if he wasn't slow to anger, he'd have wiped out America a long time ago. He'd have zapped us. We'd have been Sodom and Gomorrah. The definition here is able to remain calm. That's long-suffering. Not annoyed when waiting a long time or when dealing with difficult people or problems. So we deal with difficult people all the time, and we don't have any kind of patience with that. He's abundant in goodness. Abundant means he abounds in goodness. He is full of goodness. He is exceedingly great. So before I talk to you about goodness, I'm going to talk to you about this long-suffering thing. When we drive up, when we drive down Highway H, and there's hardly any traffic coming on the freeway, and the person in front of us just won't turn because they're afraid. They're afraid to get out in front of anybody else, and we wait, and we wait, and we wait. And it's like they've had 15 opportunities to pull out there. How's your patience doing, folks? What are you saying to one another? Stupid!
I could have pulled four buses out by now.
Exactly, exactly. So we don't have the kind of patience and long-suffering that God has, but he wants us to, and particularly with people. And he certainly doesn't want us to belittle people or call them names. So his goodness is number 2617. It is kindness, beauty, favor, good deeds, loving kindness. Well, we're in a time of Teshuva. Part of that is doing good deeds. We've been working on that, trying to do good deeds. And truth is H571. Truth is stability. There is stability in the truth, certainty, and trustworthiness. We can trust the truth of the word. Truth has another definition, 539. It is to be firm or to be faithful. So Yahweh is faithful. Jesus is faithful. That he keeps his mercy to thousands. And he's not wishy-washy in any way. He is solid. He's stable. If he says something, well, you can take it to the bank, because he doesn't lie. His adversary lies. We lie, but he doesn't lie. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He forgives iniquity. That means he lifts absolutely and he accepts you. So he lifts the iniquity off of you and he accepts you. He loves you. He knows none of us are perfect. This is a journey. This is not an arrival. You don't get born again and you've arrived. It's a journey. It's a walk. So he's faithful. Iniquities, the word iniquities is 5771, is perversity, immoral, it's moral evil, it's fault, mischief, and sin. All of these are things that he forgives. He looks at us and he knows that we have a sin nature. It is our nature to be involved in immoral evil. It's not till he comes into our life that all of a sudden we lose the appetite for that. He is forgiving. He's a forgiving God. And he doesn't hold grudges. So when he forgives, he forgets. He's not like us. Our forgiveness is usually conditional and it's incomplete. We have the saying, do me once, shame on you. do me twice, shame on me. So we can say we forgive somebody, but we may shun them, or we may have nothing to do with them. And we remember what they did. We don't know how to forget it. God does. He has that ability to just go, it's nothing. It's over. It's forgiven. He forgives your transgressions or your revolt. That's what his people do. They revolt. The national revolt, a moral revolt, or even a religious revolt. So your rebellion and your trespasses are forgiven. And he forgives your sin, which is 2403. Your sin is an offense. Sometimes it's habitual. You just keep doing it over and over and over. No matter how many times you say, okay, today I'm not going to do that. And by the end of the day, you're repenting again. Well, thank God you're repenting, because that's what you're supposed to do. We have habitual sinfulness. And it has penalties. That's why we repent. Sin has a penalty, punishment, and it also, all of that gets forgiven. Wow. Oh, to be like him. So remember this in verse 7. He will by no means clear the guilty. That's what he said. He visits the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, upon the children's children, up to the third and the fourth generation. So unconfessed sin has consequences. As we saw with David, even when your sins are forgiven, they still have consequences in this lifetime. So they don't follow you into the next lifetime, but they're going to have consequences in this lifetime. So repent now of your sins. Ask God to show you what you have not confessed or dealt with, and be cleansed by the blood of Yeshua Jesus. And he says that those sins that are scarlet, that he will make them whiter than snow. I mean, he literally changes their appearance. He makes you whiter than snow. He blots out your sin. So remember, this is right after the sin of the golden calf. There are the innocent among the children of Israel, and there are the guilty. Not everybody participated. Yahweh is a just God, and he will justly deal with each of them. He will forgive those who are innocent, and he will judge those who are guilty. And he's in the process of making a nation of priests of these people. So these are people he wanted to make a nation of priests to the rest of the world. And look what they did the first opportunity that they had. How many times did we just, darn, did we foil God's plans again? Did he have some destiny for me? Did he have a purpose for me that I didn't fulfill because I refused to do what he called me to do? I didn't want to have to get up early. I didn't want to have to discipline myself. I don't want to have to do what God said. Someone told me the other day, you know, I don't pray a lot because if I did, God would call me to evangelism, and I just don't want to do that. I might have to do what God said if I listened to him. What's the consequences of that? How many people didn't get saved because you weren't obedient? How many of your own kids might have got lost because you weren't obedient to what God called you to do? What are the consequences? So there are consequences in this lifetime. Ask God to show you what you have not confessed or dealt with, and to be cleansed by the blood of Yeshua. He says that those sins are scarlet, but they will be white. So remember, this is right after the sin of the golden calf. I just told you that. And so he's going to judge those that are guilty and those that are innocent. He's going to purge out the rebellious and the unjust. And because of Moses' intercession, he will spare the innocent among them. We are called to be intercessors. Whose life might we save if we were obedient, like Moses? So Jesus is coming for a bride without spot or blemish. So what you want to do as I ask you questions, because you all have notepads, and if you don't, you probably should, because I'm going to ask you some questions. And I don't want you to answer out loud. You can answer these when you get alone. But I want you to ask yourself, am I merciful? Am I full of compassion? Do I have a deep awareness of the suffering of others? Oh, I see some smirks. Like, are you kidding me? Accompanied by the wish to relieve that pain or the hurt? Do you show pity? Do I share in the suffering with others? How about this one? Am I sympathetic? Or do we kind of look at people and go, well, they probably made their bed, they should lie in it. Oh, they brought this on themselves. If we can see with the eyes that God sees, we may not think that way. Am I gracious? Do I stoop in kindness to others? Do I put myself out of the way to be able to do something nice for somebody else that maybe is more less fortunate than I am? Do we ever treat or see others as inferior to us? Do we favor God's children? Do we render kindness? And do we sincerely pray for people? How many times do we go, oh, we'll put you on the prayer list. Oh, we'll pray for you. And comes time to pray, we forgot about them. We didn't make a note. We didn't put it on the list. We just forgot about them. But you know, God thought it was important enough to break down these attributes. And so what he's telling us is when you love, this is what it looks like. That's why he broke it down. He didn't just come to Moses and say, I'm a God of love. No, he said to Moses, this is how I operate. I'm a God of mercy. I'm a God of compassion. I'm long suffering. You know, you're here to reason with me. So I'm telling you, we can reason together because I'm already the kind of God that would not be a harsh judge. If you can convince me there's a reason to continue with these people, well, I'll listen to you. I'll hear what you have to say. What about Sodom and Gomorrah? When Yahweh came down and he's going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah and he sends his angels, and Abraham says to him, God, peradventure there's 50 righteous in the city. God said, if there's 50 righteous, I won't destroy them. Here's Abraham interceding for the whole city. They're disgusting. They're abominable to God, and Abraham's interceding for them. You're right, Kenny. It's all about the love of God. It is. But it's also understanding what does love look like. And God's telling us what that looks like. So for all of you that didn't hear what Ken said, so he's talking about the fruits of the Spirit should be manifest in people that walk in the love of God. We should have these attributes. And so during this time of repentance, when we don't have these attributes, what I'm doing today is trying to trigger your mind to say, where am I missing it? It looks real solemn around the table. You know, you all are going, yeah, maybe I need to work on that. That's exactly why I'm doing this. It's not just you, it's me too. We are not walking where we want to walk, where we want to walk. We are not demonstrating the fruits of the Spirit. We're arrogant. We're prideful. We're ignorant. We don't know the word. We have an attitude about other people. And sometimes we just think they're just stupid and don't even deserve to live. I hear those kinds of comments. So he is ever interceding for us. And we are interceding for others, right? We're doing that? Is that right? Is that what we're doing? How about that? Are we? Do we sincerely take their needs to Yahweh? Or just do we lie when we say we're going to pray for them? So, am I long-suffering? Do we remain calm? Do we trust God to deal with people? Or do we keep trying to fix everything and everybody ourselves? Do we have the attitude that we can do it? We can fix this. Whatever it is, better than anybody else. Do we have the patience to wait for others when we eat? When we get into the car or enter into a building, do we wait for that person to go before us, or are we in such a hurry that we cut our other people off? Are we considerate? Are we slow to anger? And what about when somebody cuts you off in traffic? Or that situation where you're waiting behind the person to get onto the highway? What are you feeling? What are you feeling? You know, what we could do is go, God, that person is so fearful. They probably shouldn't be driving. I pray they get to their destination and either you deliver them from this terrible fear, or maybe they should get off the road, God. Please protect them. Okay, so do we get frustrated and easily give up on other people? I think we do. Do we look to see the good in others? Or do we have a critical and a judgmental spirit? Because remember this, with whatever measure that you judge is the way you will be judged. However you judge others is the way that you will be judged. So here we go again. Every week I tell you this, words are weapons. Words are weapons. So are you killing people with your words, or are you blessing and uplifting people? Are you abundant in goodness? That means kindness, beauty, favor, good deeds, loving kindness. Are you stable because you walk in truth? Can people trust you? Are you certain? Are you trustworthy? So only you can assess if these attributes that are in Yahweh can be found in you. So in Philippians 2:5, it says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. It all starts in your mind. It starts with a thought. If you don't think it, you won't say it. But if you think it, it's liable to come out of your mouth. So we are made in the image of God according to the scriptures. And we can actually learn to think like God. If we think like him, we will begin to reflect his nature and we will begin to act more like him. In Psalms 139:23, it says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Know me, God, know me. He knows us, we don't know him. And know my thoughts. Listen, we don't have to beg him to know our thoughts. He knows our thoughts. And see if there's any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. So God knows our thoughts and he knows our hearts. So the goal in all this is to get to the root. What makes us do what we do, even when we don't want to do it? So God cares about your motives. And he wants you to love him with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your might. You know, as I ponder on that, I told the Lord decades ago, God, I know people who love you. I know a lot of people love you, but I don't know anybody that loves you with all of their might. We're using our might for many other things besides loving God. So we want to become more like Yeshua and conform to his image, but it's a process. The key is to never give up. He never gives up on us. And all of us are a work in progress. So many of our sins happen when we are under duress or pressure. And it's during these times that we find out what's really in our heart. What are you made of? When Peter was under duress, he denied that he even knew Jesus. When he was in the judgment hall, he denied knowing Jesus. If it were not for fear, he would have never denied knowing Yeshua. Fear makes us do what we don't want to do. Fear is an emotional response. Your body responds. You don't think clearly. Your heart pounds. Your blood pressure rises. You get short of breath, and you just don't think clearly. But Yahweh says in the scriptures, the word says, that those that are fearful will not inherit the kingdom of God. How many of us are just fearful of many things? And we don't know that we won't be caught in a situation where we're full of fear, and we have to pray for God that our response will be according to his word and not according to that fear, that that fear will not overtake us. We got a scripture up on the board from Psalms 56:11. It says, I've trusted in the Lord, and I'm not going to fear what man will do to me. We keep that on the board so we don't forget that we are not afraid of man, that our fear is of God. So sometimes we place ourselves in a place of compromise. We're in situations that we have no business ever getting involved in. So perhaps that we've made a decision to participate in something that we know better than we should be getting involved in. So of course, in those situations, we don't even ask God. We often do these things without even thinking of the possible consequences or what it might lead to. So maybe you're tempted to lie or to cover something up. Anybody been through that? Everybody. Have you ever known someone that accuses you of doing what they do themselves? We see that all the time. And the truth is, because they are unjust, they just think that everybody else is too. You may have never even thought the thoughts they're accusing you of. But when they're unjust, they just think everyone else is. And so they can accuse you falsely. Let God vindicate you. There's no sense in defending yourself. Let God vindicate you. So maybe we just want to please our peers. We get caught in a situation. We just want to please our peers. Or we act in a word contrary, act in a way contrary to the word because of pressure or public opinion. And the reason I warn you about all these things is because it's coming. It's coming. It's coming in our lifetime. And we need to make up our minds now so that we're prepared. So whose judgment would you rather endure? The crowd or Yahweh? I know what my choice would be. So out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. And Yahweh is concerned about our heart, our inner man. And no one was ever tested more than Jesus himself. No one ever faced more pressure than he did. But his will was to do the will of the Father. In Luke 22:42-44, it says, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven and strengthened him. So here he's wavering, and Yahweh sends him an angel. Father, send us an angel. When we waver, send us an angel to strengthen us so that we don't make the wrong choices. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Well, none of us have ever been under that kind of stress or duress. And we never will be. So let's close with just a few questions to ask ourselves. Have I ever put myself into a compromising situation? And then when you got into trouble, you rationalized by saying, well, it was just unavoidable. It was an accident. We rationalize. We excuse ourselves for everything. We have an excuse for everything. What might help you to keep from getting into these situations again? Is there a way to put up boundaries to prevent this from occurring? Is there something you can do in your life to keep you from falling into those things again? Ask God. Ask him, what can I do to prevent this? I mean, if you got a lust for a certain food, then Don't keep it in your house. You know, just ask him. That's just a simple suggestion. God's got plenty of answers, and they're not mine. They're not my ideas. They're not my answers. But he can help you put boundaries on yourself so that you don't do stupid stuff. Have you ever wondered, while in the midst of a tough situation, how might God get glory out of this, or how might it work out for my good? Sometimes we're right in the midst of something and we go, you know, I'm sure God must have something to get out of this, because right now it don't look like it. But he always takes what's wrong, takes what's evil, and he turns it to good. What Satan means for evil, God will use for his glory. Is this as bad as it seems, or does God have something better for me? Sometimes we just get so fretful. We just worry so much. We don't have any patience to see things get worked out. Oh my God, this is happening, and oh my God, they did this, and then they did that, and then they... Is God on the throne? Is he in control of your life? If he is, it's going to work out for your good, because he loves you. So did you make mistakes because you were lazy? That's a good one. Am I lazy? Or because my flesh got the best of me? Did I give in? We all do that. So in the beginning of the series, I suggested that you keep a notebook, and I hope that you would take these questions this week and ponder them. I hope you will meditate on the attributes of God and how you might become as he is. And mostly I pray that you will be honest with God and with yourself, that at the end of this teshuva and this repentance, that you will look more like Jesus, that you will think more like Jesus, that you will act more like Jesus, because he's our example. That's what we're striving for. We're striving to be more than an adequate partner for him. We're striving to make ourselves ready. And that's why we do this. That's why we're doing teshuva. That's why we're searching our hearts. We don't want anything between us and him. We want no roadblocks in our relationship to God and to hearing his voice. I am so grateful that he loves me and that he talks to me. So grateful. And when I get into his presence, all I do is I just start crying, because my body, my physical body, can't handle just the little bit of his presence that I get to experience in prayer. It makes me weep. I can't even imagine what it will be like when we're literally in his presence. And it won't be that long. We are praying to make ourselves ready. So, Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for the wonderful, glorious attributes of God. And Kenny's absolutely right. If we would love like you love, if we would be like you are, we wouldn't have to ask ourselves any of these questions. We'd just be operating that way. Father, I ask you to take this word, cause us to search our hearts. Me too, God, that during this week I'm looking, I'm paying attention, I'm listening, I'm going, where did I have an attitude about that person? Where did I have a thought about that situation? Where did I think ungodly about something? Where did I lust after something? Where did I cheat somebody? Where did I cheat God? What did I do that was so important, that was more important than being with God? What choices am I making? Am I pleasing God, or am I pleasing myself or my flesh? Father, try us, see if there's a wicked way in us. Prove us. And Father, I pray that as your children, that we would begin to pray for our brothers and sisters that are wayward and away from you, that we would begin to understand how painful this must be to you, that so many people that you have loved, so many people that you have done remarkable, incredible things for, who have never given you one moment of their time. They prayed and they prayed and they prayed until they got something from you with a vow that they would serve you if they got it. And once they had it, they totally forgot that it came from you. Father, I pray that you would give us wisdom this week, that you would guard us, that you would guide us, that you would send an angelic presence to be around us. And Father, may we have truly a repentive heart every single day of the year, not just these times of the year, but that we would be a repentive people. You said that David was a man after your own heart, even though he was a murderer and an adulterer. But Father, he was quick to repent, and he loved you with all of his heart. God, teach us to love you with all of our heart. In the name of Yeshua, amen. So if you like the video, give us a thumbs up, subscribe, and then you'll get a notice when we have another teaching up, and share if you like. Thanks for coming. Bye-bye.